You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host as always, Billy, and for always full transparency, I'm recording after 9 p.m, so this could be a very interesting next hour because I'm running on adrenaline and it's going to be a nice good ramble. So with that being said, on the show this week is a returning guest from way back, episode, wasn't 35, that's an hour note for something else. Episode 23 from November 2020. You've also ticked off a Sharp Dojo series episode, and you were on the Christmas special of the Untitled Wrestling Podcast by SWN. So you've hit just about all of them. Coming back on the show, Stone Malone. Welcome back.
Thanks for having me again. It's a pleasure to be here as always.
Well, now we can actually speak about wrestling that's happened, because the last time we had you on, November 2020, no wrestling was happening. It was pandemic. We were fully in the pandemic. So we can actually speak about, you know, you actually doing some wrestling recently, which I'm very excited for. But before I go ahead, how's it going? How's life? How's Stone Malone?
Great. Like, as you said, the last time we spoke was a pandemic, but since that, like, everything's been just on the up. Like, you know, the wrestling, my personal life, everything's just going great for once.
It's one of those weird things, isn't it? It's, I think that pandemic time really made you kind of appreciate things a little bit more, like the little things. And I was looking at your career, we'll get through as we go along here, but yeah, you've had a pretty good three and a half, four years since we last chatted. It's been not bad professionally, I think you could say. But no, it is one of those things that you do. You just learn to appreciate the little things in life and going, but 4 years ago I couldn't do that or I couldn't do this because we were stuck in the house and all that kind of thing. So yeah, I'm looking forward to speaking to you when the world is open again.
Here we are, 4 years later.
Here we are. I was going to say with less hair, but I think I was still fairly bald when I started the recording. But then I've got an HD camera. That's about all that's different in this life.
That's a good change.
I know. Right. So the last couple of episodes, I've used this new camera, and it's been really dark around about me. And I only found out today when I looked through the settings that it was applying a filter, so it would focus on me. So it was blurring out all the sides of the...
Right, yeah.
So, you know, this is almost 300 episodes, and I still have no idea what I'm doing, clearly. Podcast. Anyway, yes, so go back to the start then. Not right back to the start of the career, but back to Return of Wrestling. When I was looking on the old cage match, it says Pro 2 was your first match, Start Fire. Was that right?
Yeah, so my first match back was Pro 2's first show, actually. It was the Weekender show. And my first match back was against Thomas Billington. And then the night after was a tag team match with myself and Unora against both the Billington Bulldogs.
I was looking through, I was like, saw Billington just going through my research. I was like, is that him who's just on AEW Collision recently? And I clicked through. And I was like, oh, there he is. So, you know, yeah. You gave him, I assume he must have taken up some tips to take on.
Oh, yeah, of course, yeah. I was like, yeah, you know, you got to do this, bud.
But what's it like in the ring with Tom Billington and the Billington Bulldogs in general, especially with their family and their history in the wrestling?
Oh, it's intense. For it being my first match back, I knew it was going to be rough, but my God, I was not expecting it to be that rough. Like, Tom's just on you. Like, the minute he had a chance to get on me, he was just there, and I was like, let me breathe, man. But no, he was just throwing me around, beating me up. Like, the match overall was pretty fun, but I was like, If I had a bit less ring rust, I probably think it would have went a bit smoother on my half.
So he was literally like a bulldog on you. That was
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
not a bad moniker. But yeah, so it was one. He's one of the guys, even though he's, I think he's probably younger than you a little bit, but was he one of those guys that you tried to maybe try and get some dungeon knowledge from while they were over here? Because they came back a couple times as Pro 2 tag champions for a little bit.
Yeah, so like the next show I seen them at, I was talking to them a bit backstage just about what they'd been up to since that show and since they were on the road. Because like I saw they were heading over to Canada, so I was asking them how they were getting in about that and just asking them if they had any advice for looking to get over there, things like that. They share a bit of knowledge, but not too much. I think they were trying to keep it a bit secretive, but just in case anyone else overheard. But whether that's just them being them or not, I'm not sure.
But that's still pretty, like you were saying, intense weekend to get back into the ring. Between our chat then, November 2020, and that match, which is a year later, so that's a big gap. How was your time spent? Was it just trying to watch and learn? Were you doing the dojo stuff, the Looking Sharp dojo things? Were you trying to get in the ring as much as you could for one to ones? What was your experience?
So at that point, I just joined Source Wrestling, and I'd be going to classes there, and occasionally I'd done a one-on-one class at Iron Girders as well. So I was just doing everything that I could do possible to get myself back into shape physically, because the gyms, although they were open, it wasn't the same as, you know, being in a ring. So like, although, oh good, I can get back into the gym and lift weights and that, it's not the same as actually getting ring time and getting the ring rust off. So I was just doing my training with Source and the odd one-on-one session at Girders just to keep myself going.
I was speaking to Gabriel Saul, a couple of days ago about that kind of thing, because he went into doing the gym, and then when he went to go do wrestling, he was like, oh no, this is not the same. Is it? And I was thinking, is it the stop? Is it just because wrestling is so stop start, whereas the gym, you just, the momentum keeps you going. But
yeah,
with wrestling, you have to move so often and so sharp as well. Is that how different it is for you between the two?
Yeah, pretty much. Because like, I feel like if I went into that match without any ring training at all, like I just went in with like the little gym training that I'd done, I'd probably have maybe not broke something, but I feel like something definitely would have popped or pulled, because the match was that intense, and with Thomas being that intense as well, like I feel like the way he was throwing me around and we were just running around with each other, like I feel like my body just would have been like, no, I'm not ready for this again, and just something would have went.
So was that just after that weekend you felt that it was just you're ready to go again, or did you need a couple of matches at Source afterwards just to kind of just ease yourself properly back into full-time ring shape?
I definitely feel like I still had a bit of ring rust about me, but training with Source and like doing the odd like sparring match when I was there, like things like that were good to help me shake that off as quick as I could, because I definitely felt like I'd lost a step, and it was showing with some of the matches that I was doing at Source, and some of the way I was moving around the ring and training as well. I was thinking to myself, that doesn't feel right, I didn't used to move that way, but eventually it all came together again.
I mean, I was looking at your first couple of matches in Source afterwards, and like you didn't kind of, there was a gap between them, of course, but you didn't really stick to a lane when it came to opponents, because it was ADM, of course, is a bit slower but more power, and then you had Taylor Veit, who is absolute opposite to ADM. So do you find it's important that you do try and keep that variety going and not just be kind of stuck in one kind of genre of match of like, oh, I just wrestle all the big lads, or oh, I just wrestle all the flippy lads? Do you like kind of mixing it up with each match as it goes?
Yeah, absolutely. I feel like if you've got a variety of opponents, like the matches will be different, and it makes you wrestle different as well. Because as you said, like if I was wrestling just ADM like every month, like yeah, we'd have good matches, but it would eventually just get to the point, okay, we're just doing the same stuff all the time. Because like he's the taller one, but like I'm the more stocky one. So it was like range versus power. So it's just like, okay, how are we gonna mix this up? And then it's just a matter of, okay, how about we put Stone in with someone like Taylor Fight? And it's like, yeah, that looks different because it makes me have to work a different match and it puts Taylor in with someone who's going to throw him about a bit. So just things like that tend to come off better, I think.
One of the more beautiful things about wrestling is watching Taylor Fight get thrown about. I don't know why, just something about him. It's just wonderful to watch him. I think it's because he's so smug. I think it's just because he's so smug and all that. You just want to go, aye, throw him. Just throw him really far. That'd be nice. I love Taylor Fight. It's one of the highlights. I've been watching the Combat League shows recently. Very slowly. I may have finished the season 2020 season by the time this comes out. Probably haven't. But he's one of the highlights just because he's just so irritating. But but it's the right kind of irritating.
Yeah, he's so good. Like everything he does on the mic and the ring, like as you said, he's just that irritating when he's speaking and some of his actions in the ring. I'm like, oh, I hate you, but God, I love watching you do what you do because you're so good at it.
When you come in with someone like that, and I suppose, again, the opposite of being at ADM, who's more stoic and all that kind of stuff, although I think that was a Christmas show, so I think that was kind of out with canon of ADM. But do you find that if you're against someone who's got a big character like Taylor Vite, that it kind of makes your night a little bit easier, that you don't have to do as much to get the crowd involved because they're doing all the work? Get the opposite reaction?
Sometimes, yeah. The crowd will hate someone like Taylor Fight, but I feel like it's also on my half to get them to just support me. Like, okay, yeah, they'll hate him, but that's not really just a significant reason for them to like me. It's like, oh, we hate him, but why do we want to like him that's fighting him? So it's like, I need to do something to get them behind me to hate him more, and vice versa. Like, I can't just exactly stand there in the corner and let him just do his thing and be like, okay, they like me now.
Fair enough. That makes all sense in the world. So 2022 was possibly one of the biggest years at the moment for Stone Malone. Just looking at the matches that you had there, we had the clash with Taylor Vite, as I mentioned. You had the thing between Source and Joe Hendry's team at Edinburgh Wrestling Academy. Mm-hmm. But the match I'm bringing up next, just whipping through there, is Pro 2 for the UEWA, say that five times fast, UEWA European Heavyweight Championship against, at the time, Andy Wilde, now Andy Roberts. Mm-hmm. Now, I've seen Andy have a few big lad matches recently, one of which being against your doppelganger, Craig Berry. But what's it like going in the ring with Andy Wilde, especially when he was on that kind of tear, as the chip on his shoulder a little bit, time for Andy wanting to prove that European heavyweight title was as prestigious as he's making it out to be? What was it like getting in the ring with Andy?
It was fantastic, because I knew it was going to be one of the biggest matches of my career, especially at that point. It probably was the biggest match. I'd even say, in terms of importance, it's probably top three of my matches so far in my career. But like being in the ring with him, like, it was just so good. Like we were able to just pounce off of each other and just lay into each other. You know, like he'd get me in the corner, brighten my chest up, and then I'd come out swinging for the fences. We would just bar each other. It was honestly one of the funnest matches I've ever had, just being in with someone like that.
It just, I don't know if it was popular at the time, but the phrase "big meaty men slapping meat," just the whole vibe of it? You just got to.
Oh yeah, we lived up to that moniker. Like as soon as he started chopping me, it's like, yeah, this is meaty men slapping meat.
It's so weird. Like all these things happen in wrestling, match types and things, you get your star ratings and all that kind of stuff. Nothing quite beats just two or three or even four massive lads just absolutely leathering the shit out of each other for 10 minutes.
Yeah. Like, I know it's a tired phrase, but like, big guys do make money, and that's why, because they want to see them beating the piss out of each other. Like, two big horses just going at it, swinging for the fences, throwing each other around, whatever. Like, that's as entertaining as the big guy versus the wee guy or two flippy guys against each other. Like, wrestling is, it's like ice cream. Like, you're always going to find your flavour and like it, but you might be somebody that likes all flavours. So it's like,
I like that you brought that up, seeing as one of your common questions into other guests is favourite McFlurry, and you thought of ice cream straight away. So I'll get this question in now, and then we'll move back on. But what is your favourite flavour of McFlurry? Has it changed?
No, it's still the Oreo one. The Biscoff one was there for a while, but Oreo will always be the top dog.
So it got one stale biscuit got replaced by another stale biscuit. I don't get it, but it's your choice. Much like wrestling, I'm going to respect your choice, even though it's wrong. I haven't had McFlurry in ages. I'm still a Smarties guy. I'm a 33-year-old with a 6-year-old palate, it seems. So give me a Smarties McFlurry.
Nothing wrong with that at all.
Might go a bit wild to go after 8 around about Christmas time when it comes out.
Oh, yeah.
I'll do. Like, this is what happens after 9 o'clock when I'm recording. I'm like a gremlin. I just end up just going all over the place. But hopefully it makes for entertainment. As long as I don't like offend anyone, you're fine.
Of course.
Yeah. So from that point onwards, you're thinking ultimate high in a match with Andy Wilde, UEWA European Heavyweight Championship on the line, and then ending the month as Source Wrestling champion.
God, to think, like, literally two nights ago this week, it happened 2 years ago, and it still blows my mind, because it was I always did see myself eventually becoming a champion in wrestling, but getting back into wrestling so quickly after the pandemic, and then going from that match with Andy to then becoming Source champion, I was like, this has genuinely been... This is it. This is me finally putting myself there as a wrestler. Like, this is me no longer a lifetime trainee or whatever. Like, this is me now establishing that Stone Malone as a wrestler.
That was the moment. So, you started 2016 and it was 2022. I mean, there's a pandemic in the middle. But yeah. 2022 was the day that you thought, yes, I'm a wrestler now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, pretty much. Like, years ago, like, in a match with Liam Thompson, I thought, okay, this is the big match. That was the biggest match at that point, and I thought, okay, I need to keep going up and up and up. I didn't quite get to that point yet, but I was slowly getting there, then pandemic. So it was like, the rise was there, but then the pandemic put it on a halt, but then 2 years ago, that all changed.
And I mean, the fact that I was looking to see who you were in the matches with, Taylor Veit again, mentioned him. He seems to be get quite a lot of, we don't pay royalties, unfortunately, Taylor, but if we did, you'd get plenty. So you beat him, and then you went into the final with Hal Rayner and DCT, who's another, who recently, I think it was like last year, retired. But he was another mainstay in Scottish wrestling, and a different kind of cat, I suppose, in wrestling as well. So Hal would have known from training and coming up in wrestling with, but what was it like getting in about with DCT? I know he's got like a fantastic mind for wrestling, so what was it like getting in with him?
Again, a great experience. Like, his style of wrestling, especially for that type of match, like, we were trying to just work it around, so it was like, okay, you look good here, you look good here, and then I'll look good here type. So it was just working, like, he's so smart, like, just being able to pick his brains during the match and then getting advice off him after the match and even before the match. Like, just being able to learn from him is mental. Like, I know he's not, some people would look at him and think, ah, he doesn't look that much, but then watching him work, you're like, no, this guy is legit and he can go with just about any style of match. It's honestly surreal being in with someone like DCT.
I don't know if it made a difference that he came from a background of kind of like what I do with the kind of analytics. I don't want to call myself an analyst, that would be terrible, but it'd be a offense to analysts everywhere. But as someone who reviews and picks apart wrestling for this kind of purpose, and then when he's in it, he's able to kind of maybe dissect it a little bit finer than maybe others in there.
Yeah.
And you're right. I got to see him wrestle 2 years ago. It was a Regal Rumble, and when he came out, it was just something. He just had the star quality about him, and it's, I don't know how you get it, but once you've got it, it's just like, whoa,
it's just there. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Honestly, what a guy.
I mean, and then you were doing quite well for yourself there. You won the Source Wrestling Championship, one of the most beautiful belts that I've ever seen in Scottish wrestling, certainly as well, which. It's a damn shame it's we'll speak about it a little bit, but it's a damn shame it's no longer active because that is a beaut of a belt. I loved it with the like kind of double ring design with the Source logo. It was just did it feel good? Did it feel good to hold? Did you do any of the things you hear about, wearing it all over the place and making sure you make reference to it as much as you possibly could to non wrestling fans?
I debated it at some points, like if I was going to my barber's, I debated bringing it down there, getting my hair cut, and then, because like my barber likes wrestling, so like obviously he knows that I'm a wrestler, so he'll always ask me, oh, have you got any shows coming up, or what country are you going to next, you know, things like that. So I was tempted to take the belt down to let him get a photo with it, but I thought, no, because don't really want to just carry this belt in public with me in case some. He thinks, who's that nut job? But like I tried to do the belt in the fridge photo that a lot of people do, but there was just so much in my fridge. I was like, you know what, I don't have the effort to take this out. So I left that.
I love that reason. It's not as I like my fridge looked really bare and it looked really, really sad to put it in there. No, I just had too much.
Yeah, literally, I was like, I'm not taking all this out, so I'll just leave that idea.
Oh man, at least I remember, I don't know if you saw anything from the first, I think it was the first day of Birth Bonanza we did, a couple of days after the belt arrived to Brent Carr. Mm-hmm. He did the old Shawn Michaels playgirl pose with it. Funnily enough, since I'm hoping to get it back for the next Bonanza, but nobody really wants to take it. For whatever reason, since the Playgirl pose, I don't know why. Maybe that could have been the answer to you keeping it forever.
Yeah, it could be. I would happily take it, but I'd maybe give it a wee polish wash just to be on the safe side.
Well, I might hold you to that now. Day of Birth Bonanza, I'm still not organised, and it's I really should at this point. But yeah, so 2022, we're talking about, that's the first half of your year. You know, wrestling Andy Wilde, becoming Source champion. And then you just got to win more belts. You went to Pro 2, defeated Saqib Ali for the Scottish Interpromotional Championship. Another bloody gorgeous belt as well.
Yeah.
You're just collecting all the really pretty ones. I don't know if that's like Infinity Stones here. I'll bring it back. So you won the Interpromotional title. Could you believe your luck at that point that you were now carrying two belts, and were you pinching yourself even after winning that?
Yeah, like it genuinely felt like a fever dream because I remember Logan Storm messaging me asking if I'd be okay to bring the Source title with me for that show, and I was like, yeah, shouldn't be an issue. Why? And he's like, oh, because I'm booking you against Saqib Ali and we're going to do a double title match. And I was like, okay, brilliant. Another one for the bucket list. And yeah, like, winning that belt, like as you said, because it's another gorgeous belt. I was like, oh my god, it's like achieved a dream just a few months ago, and then just made it bigger a few months later. Like, oh, it was such a moment, and like my mom and dad being in the crowd to witness it as well. Like that made it even more special.
Was that the one where they started believing you're a wrestler then? After seeing you win a belt, or were they the source one as well?
They cut out of it there.
Oh, right. I was going to say, is that the day your parents realized that? Well, considered you a professional wrestler after you considered yourself one a couple of months prior with the source title.
I think my mum's always considered me a professional wrestler the way she's went on about me. But yes. I think like that was the moment they were like the double title. I think that was the moment they were like, he can make a career out of this. Like he can. It's no longer just a hobby. It's like this could be a full time living.
Your mum does love you as a as parents should do. But yeah, every time a match announcement goes up and it's Stone Malone related, your mum's always there with the like, and she's always on
the likes.
On top of it. So thank you.
Number one fan.
Thank you, Mrs. Malone, for helping our website get hits so you can check out Stone Malone's next match. But no, like going through it, it's just incredible. I mean, fortunately, you lost the title at the next Pro 2 show at Battlelines, but you know, that's not important to this kind of bit of the story. But did you get a chance to carry the belts together? Because I know that. Recent experience, I spoke to Kilcom, get all the clang name drops in. You know, Speed Kill Valhalla recently did a bit with him, and he was carrying the disco and the Tri Counties title for WrestleZone.
Mm-hmm.
And I could see it was like a pain in the arse to do, but probably cool for him, just a pain in the arse for like to watch him trying to carry him about. Did you have that, or was it just the photo opportunity? You got the photo done, you were like, right, I'm going to carry them separately for a wee bit and just have them. Or were they just all together at all times?
God, there was a social we'd done when I had both belts. I'm trying to remember now if I actually brought both belts with me, because the original plan was for me to defend the source title. And I was going to say, well, if I'm defending the source title, I might as well defend my other title because it's in a promotional one. But I think I left that idea, but like I carried it around with me for like I was getting promo shots done with Dave Wilson, and I brought both belts to that, and yeah, just walk it like one belt there, the other belt there, then try to carry the suitcase, and I was like, how the folks do this?
That's exactly it. That was the exact thing I watched. I watched a Viking trying to trundle a trunk suitcase and carry two belts. I was like, I could probably offer to carry one, but I feel like that's rude to just go, can I have your belt, please? probably should have taken the suitcase, that may have been better, but you know, well, it's way past now. But yes, so top of the world, you went down to one belt a couple of months after, but you know, but getting with likes of Frank Cross, again, another person you would have come across,
mm-hmm.
pardon the pun, over your time in wrestling, and Mayhem Brooks, who you may have come across as well, because they're all kind of from the same starting point of where mm-hmm. you started. Did you feel that was kind of like a little bit of a full circle thing, where it was three guys that came from the same starting point, and
yeah,
they are fighting over a title?
Yeah, because like as you said, all three of us started at the same place, so it was good to just have like that moment of like just off the three generations, because Cross had been around a bit longer than me. So it was like, he was the old guard, I was the kind of middle guy, and Mayhem Brooks at the time was the new guy. So it was just good to have like the three generations of where we were now here competing for a belt. So like, it was a pretty cool moment.
And it just kind of gives you a little bit of I don't know, maybe not bucket list moments, but like points on your career where you go, oh, that was a cool bit. I've got to do this, I've got to do that. That's a nice little footnote to have maybe in the Stone Malone story, if it ever gets written on paper or in blogs. Mm. That's the future nowadays, isn't it? Audiobooks. so yeah, from that point onwards, though, then it became Europe a little bit.
Yeah.
We got Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. Now, from my notes here, it was the Kirk and Tillich show that you kind of started off on there. But so I don't know if we're missing European dates around about this time. But getting involved with girders at that point, was that through going through the Looking Sharp Dojo? Is that how you got to CCW? Where was the kind of, how did you get there?
So eventually, when I was still training with Source, I decided to go to the LKS Dojo because I've been hearing good things about it from, like, say, Colton Davis and Big Strong Man. So I was like, okay, I'll come along one night, see what it's like. I went along, and at the time, they were having a show coming up in Lochwinnock. So I said to Lewis, I was like, hey, is there any spots in this Battle Royal that you're doing still open? He's like, yeah, there's a spot in it if you're wanting that, mate. Like, yeah, absolutely. And that was how I got my first gig with CCW. And then eventually I went, just kept going on from there, training with LKS, training with Source, and then girders came down the line.
I have so many nice things to say about Luke King Sharp, but what he's done there with the dojo, what was it, £5 a session, and then he's morphed it into just taking over Europe, and then I think he's trying to take over Asia as well. So he's to get involved with that, he opens up so many doors and opportunities to wrestle in Europe. Was not to say that was your initial intention, but was that always in the back of your mind going, well, Lou's got a good foothold in Europe, that's maybe something that if I get involved with the dojo, that's possibly something that could be on the horizon?
It was in the back of my head, yeah. I was like, oh, if I start training here, I might get a couple of European dates, but I was just trying to make sure that I was just getting the right training in and learning from them as much as possible, and doing the CCW shows over here before getting any of the European dates, because I just wanted to get as many reps in as possible at that time, and then eventually get the European dates when the opportunities would present themselves.
So the first one I've got here, we're not totally skipping Grassroots. You had matches at Grassroots, and you lost the Source title to Glenn. We'll go for that, and then we'll go to Europe, because that's a very important footnote in our point in this story of Stone Malone, is the final night of Source Wrestling. You were the champion for a year ish at that point. You're in a Source title five-way elimination match, finally lost to Glenn Dunbar. He became the final champion in Source Wrestling. When you found out that Source was now getting moved into GPWA, and that's supposed to be Dave Devlin, that was he explained it, that was kind of what happened. When you found out that was the case, what were your thoughts? Because that was the promotion that kind of, the company that kind of you went to after all the stuff to reignite Stone Malone and continue your wrestling journey. And then, a year and a half or 2 years later, that's it now. So what was your thoughts and feelings when you found out that it was ending? And then after the match itself?
So the first thing I was thinking, I was like, oh God, here I am back at the start again. Because as you said, like, after all this stuff happened, I found myself, okay, I need to find somewhere to train. I'll go to Source. And then when I found out that Source was moving over, I was like, oh, great. Because Source was no longer going to be a school of its own. So I was like, okay, this school and promotion gave me the fire that I needed, and it reignited me, as you said. So it was heartbreaking, and it softened me a bit. I was like, God, I even considered just not coming back to wrestling as soon as after that show. I was like, I'll maybe do the dates that I've got after that and then just leave it. But I thought, nah, the fire's still there. Like, I just need to keep going and going. I'll deal with the punches as they come and eventually see where I land next. And then the final Source show. Going into that match, it was a heartbreaking thought, but I was like, you know what, it's the last show. last ever Source match, and I'm going in as the last ever defending Source champion. So go out, just put on the best show possible and make sure that you represent Source well and proud. And I like to think that I did. So even though I lost the match, I like to think I still represented myself and the school really well in that match.
It's kind of cool to see the competitors in that, of course. So it was mentioned Glendon Barr, kind of the final foundation of Source Wrestling, as it was. Yourself, who was a champion going in, ADM, who was the first? No, he wasn't. The first champion. He was, wasn't he? Yeah, he was the first Source champion. And then Grant McIver, the second Source champion. Dylan Hendry, the third. So all the former champions were in there, plus the standard bearer of Source. So it was a fitting match to finish Source on. Was just having all the top line in its championship history, and Glenn as well. So a nice way to cap it all off. So yeah, before we get to Europe, before that point, you had Grassroots as well, which again, have a look, you got in the ring with Big Ross Hauser.
Mm.
We talked about getting in with Big Andy, being a kind of just big meaty hen slapping meat. I'm assuming it's about the same with Big Ross as well.
Ah, yeah, pretty much. Although he was taller than Andy, like, it was still the same sense of, like, oh, here's two big heavyweights. Let's just go at it, swing for the fences, big meaty men slapping meat. And it was just, lane, lariat. So it was what you would expect for a big horse match, essentially.
I love watching Ross wrestle, because it is literally, like, you just get so into it. He just starts. I've seen people get chopped by him that have maybe regretted all their life choices in a moment, because he goes full in, all it. He's there's no half measures here. You're getting chopped, you may die.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Someone who's took one of those chops. Yeah, that's how it is.
Europe, then. That's the big thing here. So I've noted here Spain being your first European trip.
Yeah.
Is that correct? From
Spain was the first one.
Wonderful. So not only yourself, but Jan the Slavic one joined you, as well as Big Mick. Was there. So I'm looking sharp. So some familiar faces going over. How was your apprehensive going over to Europe? Different country, different language, different everything going over. How are you feeling about that?
Again, just thinking, living the dream here, because I'd won a title and then I was like, okay, what's the next big step? Go international. And then the chance was there. So like, when I got the message off of Lou, like, oh, we are going over to Spain for a show, I was like, first thing I'd done was thank him for getting me that opportunity. And then the second thing I'd done was literally run downstairs and tell my mum and dad that I was going to Spain to wrestle. And I was so happy, because traveling Europe, the world, anywhere to wrestle is like a part of the dream. And doing it with like my coach and some of my friends that I train with, I'm like, oh, this is just a great experience to do. So I was like, I was really excited for it.
And then third, obviously, checking to make sure your passport was valid and all that kind of
stuff. Oh, yeah. Thankfully, it was.
But I'm loving this chat. A little more to speak about. I'm loving this chat, because last time we chatted, way back when, episode 23, it was in that really just crap time, to be honest. We were trying to do stuff to keep ourselves occupied, and some people made bread, some people did Twitch, some people did a podcast. And we were not saying that we were doer, but we were a little bit, weren't we? We were just kind of like, wrestling's now happening.
Yeah.
I do want to speak about it. And now we're here 4 years later, and you're just absolutely buzzing with life, and just you're getting to do all these cool things. And it just didn't make the 2 years or so worth it, but now you can kind of go, well, I got through that, and now I'm doing all these amazing things, and I won belts, and I get to wrestle in Europe, and all that kind of thing goes with it. So it's great. It's great. I need to get more season one guests back on, because for that exact reason, because life, we're happier now.
Most of us
anyway. So yeah, into Europe, you're now ticking off countries as you go, and one of the big things then is got a little bit of a change in. Well, before was this before, had Pat and Batter already kind of split and got back together? There was that period in Pro 2 where you and the big strong man were not the best of pals. I can't remember where we are along in the timeline.
So at that point, the Pro 2 show where I lost the interpromotional belt, it was because he that cost me the belt. So that was the split there. And then down the line, after a few months, we kissed and made up, basically, and went, okay, all's forgiven, let's get back together, let's give this another run.
So I just brought that up because the big strong man, he's doing some fascinating things in wrestling. Mm-hmm. I think fascinating is possibly the best, only weird word to describe it. Wrestling Eddie Hall one weekend, and then wrestling Adam Maxted, and then just battering kids at Community Pro in the pre-show. It sounds amazing, to be honest. It sounds like an incredible life.
It's a bizarre life for him, but honestly, he's one of my best friends. Like, I'm honestly proud of you. I'm proud of him, the career he's making for himself. I hope he just keeps going with it, because what he's doing is, as you said, fascinating. That's probably the best word for it. I just hope he keeps going with it.
To say that we went to see Discovery, and he was wrestling Adam Max there on that show. So he came out, and Kelly, my wife, had never seen the big strong man. And afterwards, she was like, he's amazing. I don't know why, though. He just is. So when you guys are now trading white war stories, you're going off to Europe and getting all these cool big matches, and then big strong man, he's there going, I wrestled Eddie Hall. Do you just kind of sit and just go, this is weird. This doesn't feel like, again, those pinch me moments, pinching each other maybe on a weird way. But so just then discussing how far you guys have come in those however many years.
Yeah, when we're just sitting chatting about all what you've been getting up to, things like that, because he messaged me saying, guess what, I'm going to be wrestling. And I was like, who? And I'm like, all right, come on, give me a hint at least. And he's like, no, I feel like if I give you a hint, it's too obvious. I'm like, right, well, I can't just guess a name. So eventually I just took a guess at a wild wrestler. I think I said Doug Williams. And he said, no, he's not actually a wrestler. And I was like, right, that doesn't help. And then he's like, right, okay, I'll just tell you. I'm going to be wrestling Eddie Hall. And I was like, no, you're not. And I was like, no, you're talking shit. And no, he proved me wrong, he did wrestle, and I was like, mate, that's so cool, that's always, it's just so bizarre, because, he'd go down to Megaslam and be like, I'm the big strong man, and then the actual world's strongest man would come out and just throw him about like a wet trackie. Honestly, man, what a career.
Wrestling is the best. I don't think people really get it. Those are outside the circle. Until they actually see a show, then you kind of understand it a little bit. I've so many people that I've dragged to shows or say, just come to a live show. It's amazing. And more often than not, they're like, I might not go back again, but that was an amazing couple hours of just shouting. It's panto year round. Just love it.
Yeah.
That's all it needs to be. It's just you don't have to overthink wrestling too much. You just need to love it. And that's what we do here, for better or for worse sometimes. So yeah, big strong man, there's his big strong mention. Hopefully, and we hopefully maybe could try and get him on in the next wee while as well. That's another guy I need to get back on. I've had him on a couple of times, but it's been a good while. It's been a big strong while since we've had him on the show. And then I get to say big strong for a lot of the episode. So
yeah.
That. So after that point, God's Country became a thing. Became a thing in oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah, Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. I know your name Valor now, but I'm going through CCW and I keep mixing it up with Community Pro. Copenhagen. Now I've got Combat League in my head. Right. To Macy's, thank God you changed your name to Valor. It was getting too complicated. Yeah, God's Country. So you, Frank and the Cross, Frank of the Cross, the Warden. We've got Tim Strange, I think, it came a bit later as well. So you went from the inevitable Stone Malone to throwing all the old cowboy hats and get the old bandana around the neck. So what was there any like reason for your change in like tweak in character?
So there was a store show that I'd done where I came out with the cowboy hat and the denim jacket with the fur in it, just looking like I came off a country album, basically. The original plan for that was just to be like a one-off thing. And then the last store show, somebody said, you need to bring the cowboy back for this show. Like the outlaw going in for one last shootout. And I was like, you know what, that's actually really good. So that was the first show where I'd done like the jacket with the fringes and the bandana around the face, as well as the cowboy hat. So I'd come out, done my thing. And then a few people were saying, you should just make this your thing now. Like, keep the, still be the inevitable, but this should be the new you. This should be the change. Because, like, in wrestling, I feel like some characters need a refresher, and I feel like mine's needed a refresher at some point. And with me doing this as a one-off, and then everyone going, no, that's cool, you should keep doing this, I was like, this might be what I need. So I just stuck with it, and now here I am, still the inevitable, but just with a cowboy hat.
Just to blindside you here, did you shoot Jimmy the Ref?
I'm not saying anything.
Okay, anyway. I think it seems to be like we're talking about the panto of wrestling and just things that are cool. I don't think men especially we ever grow out of thinking cowboy hats are anything but the most coolest thing and headwear in the world.
Yeah,
because they are.
Yeah, genuinely, because like that was the idea behind it. I was like, okay, what's the most badass look you can have? A cowboy hat. Yeah, brilliant. Boom, stick it on. I was like, yeah, I'm strutting my stuff. I'm the hot shit. I'm the cool guy. And then everyone's like, keep that. Just keep doing that. I'm like, okay, I'll just keep adding to it. Fringe jacket, bandana, sorted.
Just get the old get a lasso. Have you had a lasso trainings at all? Lasso, not lasso. Lasso training. Have you been maybe keeping that?
That could be the next thing. We shall see.
But yeah, it really is, because I remember going to Disneyland for my honeymoon and like went to Buffalo Bills thing. You get a straw cowboy hat, and I was like, this is the coolest thing ever. And then went around the other shops, and there was another cowboy hat, and I kind of got swayed away not to buy it. But I go back to that picture of me wearing it, thinking, wish I bought that hat. I would never wear it in Elgin, like I'd get beaten up. But you know, I was just like felt like cowboy that I felt cool that day.
Yeah,
it's a cowboy hat. It's all it needs. It's got the wee divot where you put your hand. It's just
like it's just the coolest accessory to have.
Yeah, there should be more cowboys in wrestling. but they should all kind of make sure that nobody's crossed over the gimmick too much. You know, but they'll all blown over by now. By the time this episode comes out, I'm sure, or it's gotten worse. We don't know. Yeah, God's Country becomes a thing. You're back over to Europe, back to Italy, I should say. And yeah, you're just living the dream. It just seems.
Yeah.
Is there anywhere that you've got your eye on now? I suppose. I mean, you've hit a couple places in Europe, and is there any ones that when you're speaking to the guys at Iron Girders and they're or at the dojo and they're going, oh, I wrestled this place, and you're looking at them going, I'd like to wrestle there too. Kind of thing. Is there anywhere that's on that list?
So I think just anywhere in the world, but if I was to name any countries to wrestle in, it'd be like Denmark, just so I can cross off all of the countries that represent Valor, because I've wrestled in England, Scotland and Sweden. Denmark's the only one like on the logo I've not wrestled for yet, so I would like to cross that off. As again, USA, Mexico, Canada, you know, just like all the places that wrestling is big. And then if I was to travel anywhere else in Europe, like Germany would be so cool to wrestle in. I've reached out to a couple of promotions over there, not really heard anything back, sadly, but you never know. Hopefully that'll change down the line.
Germany love their big, strong boys. They really do. I mean, and of course, Walter Gunther came through WXW and all that kind of stuff. They like their big lads that fight, that have that. We were mentioning earlier about, like, there's a few things better than just seeing two, three, four lads just absolutely battering the shit out of each other for 10 minutes. That's how Gunther is so cool now, because he just goes in, leathers you for an undetermined amount of time, beats you with something, doesn't matter what, powerbomb, big splash, sleeper, who cares?
Yeah.
But it's just cool, because we're getting to see just someone batting the piss out of someone else, and it's legal. It's just amazing. But yeah, definitely, when you were starting to list off countries, I was wondering if Germany was going to be one that would pop up in there. Maybe even like a Japan or something like that.
Japan is a big deal as well, yeah.
That kind of thing. So after all that, you obviously were back in Attitude Pro Wrestling as well. You reformed Pattern and Batter. Are you still going by Pattern and Batter, or have you had any discussions where you need a new big strong name to go with you?
No, once we're teaming, we're always known as Pattern and Batter, and I feel like that's just the name we are forever labelled with.
Fair enough. And all that time as well, you made your debut for Iron Girders, and
yeah,
it was against Brannigan, and then you were in title matches straight away. So geez, is there, leave some of the title shots for someone else maybe, because so you made your debut, and then like next show you're in a title match. Did you feel when you debuted at Iron Girders you had that kind of same feeling as when you debuted at Source, like kind of that reinvention, you've kind of arrived at your new place, your new home for wrestling?
Yeah, a little bit, yeah, because God, I'm not sure how many months I've been training with Girders before my debut, but I remember helping out at a couple of shows before said debut, and I was like, yeah, I really just want to be in that ring and show this crowd what I can do, because the crowd's always good. And then BT said to me, we're going to give you your debut on this show against Brannigan. I was like, brilliant, sweet, thank you. Went out, done the match, got the win. I was like, okay, successful debut. Hopefully we can keep this momentum going. And yeah, it just felt great to finally get in the Girders ring and make my debut there.
I mean, I know that when you joined Girders, it was after Wolfgang had gone and went to NXT and all that kind of stuff. But is it still mad seeing him in the coffees standing with The Rock as they were his training partners for WrestleMania? Is that still, like, to think that you're in that kind of, you're in Girders, so there's possibly a good chance that Wolfie's watched your match back for some feedback or whatever, and he's turned to The Rock going, see this guy with the cowboy hat? He's amazing, kind of thing. That's a possibility, infinite possibilities. That
could be. Like, honestly, so wrestling is mental now, like, as you said, because, like, Wolfgang the Coffee's training with The Rock. Like, I can now officially say that The Rock is Girders built. And honestly, it's like everything about it is so bizarre, just knowing that Wolfgang will be watching matches back and he'll be taking notes, be ready to give feedback, like, whenever he gets the opportunity. As you said, like, possibly showing The Rock, like, check this guy out, Stone Malone. Like, that's how we're going to shape him into our Rock, or something like that.
Oh my God, I didn't even think of the crossover there. Stone Malone, The Rock, it's all coming together. This is it. But that is, it's just, it's really shows, like, when you started training in 2016, the Scottish wrestling boom was like, it was okay, you know, but I don't think there was as many opportunities to go places. You had Drew, you know, and he was like an anomaly for a very long time. And nowadays, that you're not that far away from reaching your goal if you just if you hit the right moment, you're at the right spot. And yeah, again, it's just mad to think of that. Like, I like to think that The Rock's got a girders built t-shirt vest. Obviously, it has to be a vest.
Yeah.
And he just cuts about with it, and then when he gets the camera on him for something, he has to take off to put on his Rock gear and stuff like that. That's just, just move aside the Stone Malone merch as well, because obviously, you never know. I mean, I don't know if you check your emails for your merch or that. You never know. The Rock at therock.co.uk.com would be .co.uk. That'd be crazy. of all the things, that's the crazy part. But yeah, so it's just it's just such a small world of wrestling nowadays that if that's not an impossibility that The Rock knows who Stone Malone is.
That's
what I'm saying. I got all excited there just thinking about The Rock with a Stone Malone t-shirt. This is just what happens when we record late. But anyway, so girders, you're in girders now. Got your title match with Eddie Castle. Into the King of the Fling as well, you know, just Stone Malone, just getting all these titles, all these title opportunities.
Yeah.
And then you're kind of back in the tag division a little bit now with Big Mick. And you had a couple of matches with Casino Brutal.
Yeah.
I've asked this a couple of times against people who've went from like two singles guys, wrestling two singles guys and then wrestling tag teams. Is there a difference? Do you notice a big difference between wrestling two individuals as opposed to wrestling a tag team like Casino Brutal?
I would say so, yeah. Like, wrestling an established team like Casino is a different experience from, like, for talk's sake, me and Big Mick against Jimmy the Ref and Brannigan, just for talk's sake. Like, they're not a team. We are not really a team, but, like, it's just these two guys versus the two guys. And then, like, It would be a good match, but like wrestling a team like Casino is just a whole different level of tag team wrestling, because they've wrestled with each other so many times. They just know each other like the back of their hands. They don't even really need to communicate. Like, they can just look at each other, give a signal, a look, whatever, and they know, okay, we're doing this now. And it's like, well, Jesus, what's going on here? But yeah, it's a whole different level being in with a team like Casino Brutal.
So we've got loads of questions. We've got loads of questions actually coming through. So I'm gonna just get through them. Let's do this. We'll start with Facebook we'll start with Twitter because I have not loaded up Facebook, which is very unprofessional of me. I will try and do that in the meantime. So we've got Zach Atlas on Twitter, or X, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
He didn't ask a question. He's put, it's my rootinest tootinest pal. Tell him I say hi, and that's a very nice hat. See, Zach, you're on the same wavelength. You're on the wavelength.
Yeah. I mean, Zach knows. I mean, he's got the pirate hat, the cowboy hat, like all the two coolest hats you could possibly have.
So, I mean, you got to throw Fez in there, but that's just more a Doctor Who thing. That's just more nerdy than anything else. But if you see a Fez.
Fez are cool.
Fezes are cool. You know what? It's underrated. I only found out, well, only realised properly recently. Bucket hat.
I've never worn a bucket hat, so I couldn't really say.
I am shocked. That's the big headline here. Nay, The Rock owned Stone Malone gear. It's the fact that you haven't worn a bucket hat. I went to a festival recently, and I just wore it for the whole weekend, and it was just like, I feel cool. I saw pictures back. I didn't look cool, but I felt cool, and that's the most important.
Yeah, that's the main thing.
Chaotic Lucha himself, Sammy Sparks, he's got a couple. Mm. Well, not really. He's put no question marks, so I don't know if these are questions or just statements. He has put, I need you to say, we have fun here, boys, in a deep voice to him. Oh, is that to me?
Yeah.
Okay, hang on. We have fun here, boys. Is that deep?
Okay. So, a trip. This is like a ongoing thing between myself, Sammy, and Charlie Anderson. So when we went to Sweden to wrestle for Lights Out, the three of us would be sitting, and Sammy would go, okay. I would say apple pie, and then Charlie would go, we're fun here, boys, and let the deepest voice you could put on, and it's just an ongoing thing.
Charlie Anderson with one of my favorite promos of with them saying simply the best and almost causing a riot at Girders, which I watched it before I spoke to him for the podcast, and I was like, this is possibly the best thing I've ever seen. It was just because it was so left field.
But yeah.
Was it one of the key? I can't remember. Was it one of the KOE stood up to fight him? Oh, it was amazing. He's also asked, is he looking forward to another fight? Oh, hang on. Is he looking forward to another flight with the Chaotic One?
I mean, yes, because both flights, like to Sweden and back, like we didn't sit next to each other. So, of course, I'm going to be looking forward to them.
Oh, I remember this. Yeah, we had Legend Never Die on. There was chatter about Sammy Sparks's flight shenanigans. Am I remember that rightly? Someone's flight shenanigans.
I know what you mean now. So, the flight home, we're at the passport checkout.
That's it.
And but me, Sammy and Charlie were just buzzing from wrestling, and we were just shouting yeah the entire time and like listening to the wrestling songs, and then one of the security ladies comes over and goes, you three, come with me, and the three of us were standing there like, are you being arrested? What's going on here? And then a guy's standing, and then he's like, all right guys, three is just lining up here and get you hanging. I was like, are we in trouble or something? Like, no, we're just, these are being really loud, so we're just getting you out of the line, basically. And I was like, we've basically had a fast pass for just being menaces to society. It was great.
Did you have a belt at that point? Oh, no, would have been after sourcing into promotion. Ah, could have shown off the belt as well. Like, I'm a big deal, I get the fast pass because I'm the champ.
Kind of thing.
The boy was there going, I saw you win the source title, so we'll just let you through. So don't take that as advice, people that are listening and watching.
Oh no, it's not advice. No, we were lucky.
It could have been a very different situation, and other things may have happened if it was any other day. Right, on to Instagram. We've got loads here, and I've failed Jake Berry's request, but we'll get to that in a second. Ian Skinner.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone probably knows what this question is going to be, but I'll read it again verbatim. Would you rather have unlimited bacon, but no more games, or games, unlimited games, but no games?
Second option.
You don't like bacon? Oh, wait, I mean, there's no bacon mentioned in that, actually. God, this question opens up so many portals every time I read it. Because, yeah, there's no mention of bacon in the second one. But Ian, why do you do this to me? Just
I feel like it's just Skinner being Skinner.
I think he's just... He breaks my brain every time I ask it. And I need to move on. Right, okay. One of the creepier questions that I've got sent through is from Kevin Livers. He has asked... Who's your favorite dirty sinner? Please, nobody clip that, because I don't want to hear myself say that back.
My favorite dirty sinner. I'd probably need to say the man who asked the question. I'm not sure why he would ask that, but I mean, if that's the answer he wants, then I hope he's happy with it.
Feel a little bit dirty myself now. That's we've got the Jan the Slavic one himself. He has asked, who's your favorite Slav?
Ah, it has to be Jan.
Not Stan. Stan, they're getting
Stan, nah, fuck him. Jan, he's the good one.
I like that you've waited an hour to get your first F bomb in, and that's what it's for. It's just love it. We've got Old School Cool himself. Why is he such a handsome yeehaw man?
Genetics, I guess.
Craig Berry, first question was, well, only question was, ask him how does it feel to be confused for one half of the Meat Factory?
you get used to it eventually, but once people notice the beard, they go, oh, wait, you're not Craig.
You surely there's some sort of trio thing going on here if you want to be honorary, why pick a word I can't say, if you want to be an extra member of the Meat Factory. You know, there's got to be a little bit of a, surely.
I'd be happy to do it. If the lads are looking for a third body, I'm more than happy to fill that spot.
So he also put bonus points if you call him Craig for the duration of the interview. And this is the one time I think I've said my guest's name so many times in the interview as well, which so I can't even back out going, oh, I haven't said the name at all, but I think I've called you Stone Malone like 10 times in the last hour. we've got Morgan MC underscore X with what's been your best match so far this year and why?
This year. I'd probably say my most recent match, which is my match against Ozzy Miller for Valor in Sweden. Just one of the crowds, like they were up for everything, like they were just constantly being loud, and Ozzy was such a good opponent as well, considering it's the first time I'd ever met him or wrestled him. Like everything we'd done went smooth. Like it just was one of the best matches I've had to date, I think, and I feel like it's been my favourite match this year so far.
Wonderful. I mean, I've just realised I haven't really looked at my notes at all. This, I'm just making sure that I've definitely ticked everything off here. Yeah, pretty much. I didn't write many, to be honest, which is always a good sign. Going forward, then we've kind of covered the last four years of Stone Malone. Going forward, then you're starting to conquer Europe. You want to hit Denmark, but is there any promotions that are on your you want to get there as soon as you possibly can, try to etch a Stone Malone like spot for you? Is there any promotions that you want to get to sooner rather than later?
Again, just any and every promotion that I can get to, be it here back home or even in England, you know, anywhere in Europe, anywhere around the world, I'm more than happy to wrestle pretty much anywhere. If I had to say a promotion, then WXW in Germany would probably be one of the big ones European wise. And if I was to go back to Spain, I would quite like to wrestle for Lucha Libre Barcelona. Like I've noticed a lot of their shows are picking up a lot of momentum and they bring in some big names and the crowds always look good. So there are a couple of promotions just off the top of my head, but yeah, just any promotions that I can get into, I'd be more than happy to wrestle for.
I know what one thing makes a cowboy hat look cooler: lucha mask. Got a lucha mask on, cowboy hat off. That's living the dream.
I might need to get in touch with my Mexican cousin El Stoney Maloney.
Yes, El Stoney Maloney needs to check his passport. Oh no, he'll be local. Yeah. Doesn't need to do that. It's fine. So, in the same vein, cliche question, really. Opponents, is there anyone that you've come across that you want to get in there with? I think BT Gunn was mentioned last time as one. I assume if you haven't already, I assume he's still high on that list.
Yeah, he's still up there. Yet to tick his name off, so he's still up there. Anyone else? Seb Silpers, he's one I would like to get in the ring with and mix it up with. Just watching him wrestle like for Valor and like everything he does is great. I feel like me and him could have a really good match. Nitro Green as well, like watching him when he first came over for Pro 2 and then seeing him on CCW and Valor, like everything he does is great, and like he's another one of the names I would like to wrestle at some point.
So before we go and wrap up, I think the most important question I've got here is Deadpool and Wolverine. Are you hyped? I'm hyped.
Absolutely.
I'm so hyped. I'm
like just... every trailer, every teaser, everything, I'm like watching it. I'll watch it like 10 times before sharing it. Like I'm just So like, excited.
I thought my excitement levels for a film were top for Spider-Man, No Way Home.
Yeah.
Because all the rumors of three Spider-Man in it, and I was like, oh my god, it's gonna be the most amazing film ever. Yeah. But you haven't really seen much of the variants. You've seen bits and pieces, but knowing that the possibility is endless in Deadpool and Wolverine, that you could see something absolutely batshit mental in it.
Especially knowing Deadpool, you're like, something batshit is going to happen. I cannot wait.
If they've put the corpse of Giant Man in the trailer, like, how where do you go from there, kind of thing? I'm so excited. So yeah, not a wrestling question to end in, but I'm absolutely buzzing for it. So thank you very much for joining me. Where can people find out more on your social medias, your merch? Where, just direct people, plug your shit.
So you can find me on Twitter/X StoneMalonePW. Instagram is the same, StoneMalonePW, and you can find me on Facebook. If you're interested in any of my merchandise, I sell t-shirts. It shows also online. If you want to just message me, let me know your size or see if I've got it in stock. I also sell bandanas and wanted posters at shows. So if you're interested in things like that, again, just give me a shout and I'll see what I can do for you.
Fantastic. Well, thank you for joining me, Craig Berry. This has been a great chat, and I'm looking forward to catching up again in the future. Yeah, this has been great.
Thanks for having me again.